It is a joy to be with you this morning. Let me pray. Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your word. It is a gift to us. I pray that you would use it for our good today. Remind us of who we are and who you have made us to be. Help us to hold on tightly to your calling and to perform it in a way that glorifies you and not ourselves. Help us to trust you and your perfect plan. Help us to be faithful pointers of you at all times. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Well, as Eric said, my name is Jonathan Davis. I am a pastor, and I've gotten the joy to serve since 2018 to beginning of 2020 at Waverly at Grace Baptist Church. We are right now searching for our next opportunity to serve, and it's a joy for me to get to bring the word to you today. As Eric mentioned, I do have 3 2-year-olds today, and for the next 3 weeks, I will have 3 2-year-olds, and then the two other 2-year-olds will turn 3. So for this little window, it's a special time for our family, and we do covet your prayers. I've had the joy of being able to open the Word, and it's my joy to open John 3 to you this morning, verses 25 through 30, if you open your Bibles and read along with me. John 3:25-30. Now a discussion arose between some of John's disciples and a Jew over purification. And they came to John and said to him, "Rabbi, he who was with you across the Jordan, to whom you bore witness, look, he is baptizing, and all are going to him." John answered, "A person cannot receive even one thing unless it is given him from heaven. You yourselves bear me witness that I said, 'I am not the Christ, but have been sent before him.' The one who has the bride is the bridegroom. The friend of the bridegroom who stands and hears him rejoices greatly at the bridegroom's voice. Therefore, this joy of mine is now complete. He must increase, but I must decrease." This is the word of the Lord. So as we look at this passage, we start with some questions. There's a bit of a mystery at the beginning. What's the discussion that was going on? We don't get to find out entirely. We know they were talking about the rite of purification, what we understand as baptism. We know that it was John's disciples and a certain Jew, and we know they came to John to pose their question, but we don't know what their question really was. So we're going to dig into this passage, see if we can discover what the question was based on the information that's given to us. My outline, the main point is that he must increase and I must decrease. We see that in verse 29. Sorry, verse 30. And John gives 3 reasons that he must increase, but I must decrease. The first reason he gives in verse 27, we're going to see it as sovereignty. The second reason from verse 28, identity. And the third reason from verse 29 is purpose. So let's dig into this discussion. What's happening here? What's this all about? So we begin by picturing the setting. To understand what's going on, we need to understand what's going on. They're out in the countryside, they're outside of the city, they're away from Jerusalem, they're at the Jordan River, someplace in the Judean countryside. Archaeologists think they've got it pinpointed down to one of 2 places. We don't really know. But we know that the water was plentiful and the people were coming to be baptized. So there's 2 groups baptizing people. And then someone comes up and this conversation begins. So as I look at this conversation, I'm trying to imagine in my mind, okay, what was going on, right? We see the comments that come out of that conversation to John, but we don't see the conversation. So in my imagination, I'm coming up with the conversation that's happening between John's disciples and this other Jew. And my first thought is, hey, weren't you guys doing this first? I mean, doesn't John the Baptist, I mean, that's what he got his name for, right? Wasn't he doing this first? Wasn't he the first one doing it? Who's this other guy? What's happening over there? How come he's more popular? Does he have something better? What gives? And maybe another question. Is what they're doing and what you're doing, are they the same? John's disciple goes to John and says to him all these comments, but he kind of incriminates himself by the phrase, and all are going to him. Now, we know from the text as we read it that that's not a completely true statement. It's an exaggeration, because we know from the text that there are baptism happening in both places. So they can't all be going to Jesus. So the heart of John's disciple is presenting this complaint. So the big question, I think, that is being posed here to John is, why are more people going to Jesus and less to you, John? I think that's probably the question that's being posed that John is answering. And we see his answer. And he starts with his first reason for the why more people are going to Jesus and less to John. His first answer is sovereignty. John answered, a person cannot receive even one thing unless it's given to him from heaven. Now, I read that and I think about all the stuff I don't have. And the first thing that comes to my mind is a 2014 Mercedes AMG SLS Black Edition. 6.3 liters V8 engine. Big roadster. Big. Beautiful lines, like 6 feet of hood we're talking about here, okay? Amazing car. It's not in my garage. It's not in my garage. So why don't I have this amazing car, this amazing two-seater, fast car, beautiful car, gull-wing doors, huh? Yeah, this is a great car. I mean, a great car. Why don't I have one? Well, I have 6 kids, which is why I drive a minivan and a Prius. It's kind of a shameful thing to admit for a car guy, but it's efficient and I'm saving money, so that's good. But I couldn't fit the 8 of us in this Mercedes. But it has the horsepower to pull those, I can tell you that much. Why don't I have one? Because there's a jar on my dresser with my change in it, and I haven't quite put enough in there. That's why, another reason why I don't have one of these cars. It is, in honesty, at list price, a little over $500,000. So, I mean, that's another reason that I don't have one. Ultimately, the biggest reason I don't have one, though, is because God hasn't given me one. Now, he might use means to accomplish that. Some generous person saying, Jonathan, we really like you. We think you should have this car. And I'll say, I think you're right. But he also uses other means, like that little jar on my dresser that I keep filling with quarters and nickels. But I don't have one, because God hasn't given one to me. The reality that there's more people going to Jesus isn't a problem for John. He doesn't see this as an issue. It doesn't faze him. He's happy with what God is doing. His answer, why are more people going to Jesus than to you? He says, no one can receive anything unless it's given to him from heaven. Okay, a sovereign God is giving all of those who are coming to be baptized to Jesus. God's doing that. And he's also sending the ones that are going to John. And that's a good thing, because that's part of his plan. John's not only happy with what God's doing in his sovereignty, he's quite satisfied. His joy is complete, he says in verse 29. His joy is complete that this is the way things are going. This is a good thing. A person can't receive even one thing unless it's given to him from heaven, just like my dream car. Therefore, Jesus and John are both getting the right number of people to be baptized. And John, the author of this book, doubles down on that claim that John the Baptist makes. Chapter 6, verse 37 and 38, all that the Father gives me will come to me. And whoever comes to me, I will never cast out, for I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. This is Jesus talking. He's saying, anyone who comes to me, the Father is giving. That's how it works. Sovereign God is working out his plan. God has sovereign authority over all things. In John 19, verse 11, Jesus speaking to authorities. He says, you would have no authority over me at all unless it had been given to you from above. Therefore, he who delivered me over to you has the greater sin. Talking to Pilate. Your authority, Pilate, has been given to you by God. So God's sovereignty dictates many things for us. All things. Paul says, too, in 1 Corinthians 4:7, for who sees anything different in you? What do you have that you did not receive? If then you received it, why do you boast as if you did not receive it? Everything that we have is a gift from God. Boasting in our own giving ourselves of things like salvation is kind of like boasting in your favorite sports team. Boy, I wish we'd have done better at the playoffs this year. Boy, I wish we had won that last game. I've never, out just randomly in public, met so many people on so many different teams. It's amazing. You walk into Hy-Vee and you find Chiefs players who are just walking around in there. Because they're saying, we should have done this or that. Well, they won. But what did any of these people have to do with anything that any of those teams did? Absolutely nothing. And us boasting in our own control or in our own ability or in our own accomplishments is a lot like that. And the corollary that goes along with that, the opposite of boasting, the complaining that happens, our frustration with circumstances, our disappointment with the way things are turning out, they might be showing some dissatisfaction in our own heart with the sovereignty of God and his plan for us. That's a hard word to hear. We like to quote to ourselves from Romans, we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purposes. This is an encouraging word for us. Question I have is, do we really believe it? Or are we just trying to make ourselves feel better? The reality is that God is sovereign over all things. The reason more people are going to Jesus than they are to John is because that's what God wants to have happen right now. It's part of his plan, and he's using it for our good and his glory. So God sovereignly gives. And that brings us to reason number two, identity. So we have a progression happening here. God's sovereignty, God is sovereign, He gives everything, and part of what He gives us is who we are. Who we are, the face that you have, even whether you're wearing a mask or not. The face that you have is the one that's given to you by God. Your identity is found in Him. You are made in His likeness. You are His image bearer. God sovereignly gives. And only the artist knows best what he's created. Now, John the Baptist didn't pick his calling, did he? It was told to him who he's going to be and what he's going to do. John received that sovereignly, even before he was born. He explained it himself in verse 28. You yourself bear me witness that I said, I am not the Christ, but I have been sent before him. This is a testimony that he's basically repeating now from John 1, verse 19 through 23. Let me read. This is the testimony of John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, who are you? He confessed and did not deny, but confessed, I am not the Christ. And they asked him, what then? Are you Elijah? He said, I am not. Are you the prophet? He answered, no. So they said to him, who are you? We need to give an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself? He said, I am the voice of the one crying out in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord, as the prophet Isaiah said, which we heard earlier. Jumping down to verse 29. The next day he saw Jesus coming toward him, and he said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, after me comes a man who ranks before me, because he was before me. I myself did not know him, but for this purpose I came baptizing with water, that he might be revealed to Israel. And John bore witness. I saw the Spirit descend from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but he who sent me to baptize with water said to me, he on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain, this is he who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. And I have seen and have borne witness that this is the Son of God. John is informing us of his identity that is sovereignly given to him by God. He's a pointer. John is a pointer. He's saying, not me, him. Not me, him. Look to him. Think about this. If you're out for a walk, and let's say you get lost in the woods. Let's say I'm trying to head home to a little two-year-old's birthday party, and I get lost in the woods. I'm walking around. I don't know which way to go. It's a cloudy day. Can't find the sun. What am I going to do? Well, I'm searching around, and let's say I come across a compass. Now, do I find this compass and I rejoice? Look, I got a compass. This is the greatest news ever. I've got a compass. It's an amazing thing. Check out my compass. This is so great. No, the compass isn't the point. The compass is a pointer. It's going to tell me which way I need to go. I don't rejoice in the compass. I rejoice when I get to my destination. The compass just helps me get there. Compass is a good thing, but it's not the ultimate thing. The ultimate thing is the destination. Like John, our identity is sovereignly given to us. And our role as believers in Christ is to be pointers just like John. Now, this becomes difficult when somebody comes over to your house and waxes on about how great you are. What a great host you are. What a wonderful friend you are. What do we want to say? Oh, thanks. You know, appreciate that. That's really kind. It's true. I am. No. It That's not true. I'm a sinner from the depths. I'm the guy that's stuck in the mud and the mire. I'm the one that needs to be lifted out. Don't look at me. Look at him. One ditch of identity is to get wrapped up in our own identity, that we want the attention for ourselves rather than to be ones that point back to Christ. We get so self-centered, and it's so easy for us to do. That sin is so easy for us to get tangled up in. But the truth is, it isn't about us. We don't want to be saying, look at me. We want to be saying, look at him. That's one ditch. Another ditch is ignoring our identity to be pointers of him and rather point to the things around us. Isn't that a great-looking tree over there? Did you see the new building they put up? Isn't that something? We end up pointing at other things, and we say, look at that, instead of look at him. We need to be pointers of Christ. That's what he called us to. That's what the Great Commission is all about, making disciples who are going to join us in the proclamation, just like we were doing earlier, in our worship of our great God. We need to be pointing back to Christ. We need to look at him, and we need to tell our friends and neighbors, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. We need to tell them about the hope that we have. We just got to adopt these three amazing children. But it's highlighted the theme of adoption for me in Scripture. I'm the adopted one. I'm the runaway that's got a new home because of Christ. We're either dead people walking around not knowing that we're dead, or we're adopted children of the King. Now, we want to avoid the Pharisees' folly. This is that first ditch of self-centeredness. Thank you, God, we would say. Thank you, God, that I'm not like that other person that I just heard about on the news that did that awful thing. Or maybe a little closer to home, like my neighbor. Like the gay guy across the street. Thank God I'm not like him. Thank God that I don't live in that part of town. Thank God I've got a better job than that guy. Thank God my kids are better behaved than hers. No, we need to be like that tax collector. Have mercy on me, God, a sinner. Just like every other of the 7 billion people wandering around on this planet right now. Our identity is built up in who God has made us to be. He made us to be adopted as his children, saved by his grace. And he wants us to be pointers and help others find the hope and love that we have in our adoption and spread that to the nations, so thousands and thousands more can come and joyfully participate in this family gathering and in the ultimate family gathering that is to come. So identity is sovereignly given. God sovereignly gives identity, and identity helps us understand purpose, our third reason. I'm going to read from the Christian Standard Bible, John 3:29. He who has the bride is the groom, John says, but the groom's friend who stands by and listens for him rejoices greatly at the groom's voice. So this joy of mine is now complete. Now, the purpose of a bride and a groom, if they were talking about this room, is the bride would come in the back door there, and the groom would be up here waiting, and the bride would come forward, They would come in as two separate people, but you know they're walking out together. Right? They're walking out together. One flesh, new creation. This is a beautiful thing. So we get this illustration of a wedding. Their identity is determined by their purpose. The guy standing up here, we know who he is. You come to a wedding. There's a guy standing up right here. He's a groom. What's his purpose? Walk out with the bride. And the bride, she's going to walk in. And you know who she is because everybody stands up. And she walks down that aisle, and we know her purpose is to walk out with the groom. Identity determines purpose. So we got the groom now, and we have the bride up here. We have the groomsman and the bridesmaid, and then there's this best man that John's talking about. The best man rejoices in the voice of the groom. He says, "That's my buddy. I am here for him. I'm here to support him. I'm here to cheer him on. I'm here to celebrate the love that he and his bride-to-be have together. I'm here to be witness to support them as they go through life together. That's my man. I'm here to support him." Now, what if he did something different? This is the picture that John's painting for us with this illustration. What if the best man, who we know his purpose, right? Support the groom. What if he walks over here, whispers something in the bride's ear, and they walk out together? Scandal of the highest order, right? Betrayal of the best friend, taking away his girl. The groom isn't going to pick someone to be his best man who's going to betray him. John's forerunner of the Christ. John's the forerunner of the Christ. He's the one to announce the coming of the Messiah. Not me, him. His purpose is to be that pointer. His identity as the forerunner tells us what he's about. Identity determines purpose. Now, if I came in here with a sledgehammer over my shoulder, you'd be thinking, oh, this guy's about to break something. Right? That's what a sledgehammer's for. What if I said, I'm heading out to the garage, I'm going to go fix the bike? It doesn't make sense, does it? It's the wrong purpose. It's the wrong tool. I'm not going to do anything to that bike but make it worse with a sledgehammer. It's not the right purpose. Identity helps us to understand purpose. We get our identity right. We understand what he's made us for. And he does this sovereignly. It's his gift to us. Now let's discuss the baptism, John's baptism. He's supposed to be the forerunner. He's supposed to be baptizing people. This is the thing that's leading up to the Christ. It's the difference between these two groups that are down at the river, right? So what is it? John says, "I baptize you with water," Mark 1:8, "but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." John's disciple, the one that's asking the question, has missed the point. He's complaining that they're losing market share. He doesn't get it. He's missed it. He's complaining that what's supposed to be happening is happening. I don't like it. It's easy for us to get blindsided by false identities. See, John's disciple thought they were in the business of being baptizing people, and they wanted to be the best at it. That's not what John's purpose is. We get blindsided by these false identities. We forget sometimes that we're image bearers. I mean, we're human beings. The earth is literally filled with 7 billion image bearers of God. It's like that should be the easiest thing for us to remember. not only when we look into a mirror, but into the face of any other human being. God's got a purpose. God has made this person. They're an image bearer of God. They can look completely different from you, but you still know they're an image bearer, worthy to be loved. This disciple is forgetting John's purpose. He's got amnesia. He's missed the identity piece. So that brings us to John's main point, verse 30. He must increase and I must decrease. God sovereignly gives identity, which helps inform our purpose. This isn't about us. This isn't about us. As much as you think your life is all about you, which would seem natural, it isn't. Life here is a vapor. Not smoke like from a cigarette that just kind of lingers in the air. I'm talking like those vape things, you know? They blow that out and poof, it's gone. That's us. 70 years. Gone. Eternity with Christ. 70 years. Eternity with Christ. Think about that timeline. That is our identity. We understand our purpose better when we know the end of the story. Salvation does not come from us. It comes from God. We can't save anybody. God saves everybody who comes to Him. So we remember these truths. Remember that Jesus is our sovereign God. We remember that Jesus gives us our identity. We remember that Jesus gives us our purpose. And our purpose is to be His bride. Think about that wedding. The wedding feast of the Lamb is coming. In the end, we are going to be the ones standing across from Christ. There will be no best man coming to subvert us and pull us away from Himself. It'll be us being unified with Christ forever. We don't want to get distracted by the destination, from the destination by the compass. We want to be the compass and be pointing others to Him. We aren't going to be chasing after other suitors, especially the one that you find in your mirror. We are the bride of Christ, and the best is yet to come. We like to wear and throw around the title of evangelical. It's part of the name of this church. It's a badge that identifies us, right? But I wonder, if we're going to be honest with ourselves, do our lives really line up with the risk-taking that evangelism is? Of the risk-taking that proclaiming Christ as the only way is. The risk of naming Jesus Christ as the only hope for the nations. Of speaking out loud the truth that the only hope for the problems that plague our culture and our society is found in Christ alone. Are you willing to be that weird Jesus person that can't shut up about how amazing our God is in His love that He sent to us in Christ to be our salvation? We have salvation because someone stood in our place. Someone took our sin. Someone took our punishment. And there's hope. Our death on our own shoulders, He took for Himself. To spare us, to save us. Are you willing to take on that identity as God has given to all who call themselves Christians and proclaim this truth? If you were all to do that this week, that risk, what would next week look like? How would your life be changed because of it? Who would be the new friends and brothers and sisters in your life? Let's receive sovereignly from God's hand our identity as pointers to Christ, and with intentionality be those who will point others to the only hope we have in life and death. Let's pray. God, I thank you for your word, for the truth that you teach us through it. Pray that you'd help us to keep our eyes on you, to not be stuck in the merry-go-round, chasing after lies, but keep us onto your path, remembering who we are, your bride, bought with a price. Help us to know you deeply, to love you more than we love ourselves, to share your love with those around us so that they too can know your amazing love. In Jesus' name, amen.
Was lost in darkest night, yet thought I knew the way. Sin that promised joy and life has led me to the grave. I had no hope that you would own, a rebel to your will. And if I had not love me first, I would refuse you still. But as I ran my hell-bound race, indifferent to the cost, you looked upon my helpless state and led me to the cross. And I beheld God's love displayed. You suffered in my place. You bore the wrath reserved for me. Now all I know is grace. Hallelujah. Jesus is my life. Hallelujah. Let's anticipate that day when we will see our bridegroom face to face. I invite you to stand. Sing a song of celebration, lift up a shout of praise, for the bridegroom will come, a glorious one. And oh, we will look on his face, we'll go to a much better place. Dance with all your might, lift up your hands and clap for joy, for the time's drawing near when he will appear. We'll go to a much better place. A strong, pure, spotless bride. And we will dance on the streets that are golden, the glorious bride and the great Son of Man. From every tongue and tribe and nation will join in the song of the Lamb. Time of rejoicing is
sing aloud, for the time of rejoicing
is the risen King, our groom is soon to appear.
Risen King, our groom is soon to appear.
Wedding feast to come is now near at hand.
Wedding feast to come is now near at hand.
Lift up your voice, proclaim the coming God.
Streets that are golden, the glorious bride and the great Son of Man. From every tongue and tribe and nation will join in the song of the Lamb. We will dance on the streets that are golden, the glorious bride and the great Son of Man. From every tongue and tribe and nation will join in the song of the Lamb.
Glory and honor, glory and honor, glory and honor forever. Glory and honor. This week, may you know his love as your bridegroom. May you know that you are a beloved bride. And would you also be like that best man and point to Jesus? Would he be the focus of your life? Wherever you go, may Jesus flow out of you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Have a great week.